We're glad to have Kirk Dearman back with us, and he's going to lead us in our prelude. We are the prelude. I think you know this. Let's stand and make a joyful noise to the Lord.
Hear now the call to worship. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people. Praise for all his saints, for the people of Israel who are near to him. Praise the Lord. If you would, I invite you to grab a hymnal and remain standing for hymn number 68, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Father, we do come to praise you today, along with all the saints around the world and even now with you in heaven. Help us to praise you as constantly as the things we just sang about. Praise like the wind and the clouds and the moon and stars, as constantly as the water and fire. But help us also to worship you as well as those who have gone on before us, who are now in heaven with us and with the angels until we join them at the end of our lives, and most gloriously after the end of all things here below. And it is then the name of the coming one, your son Jesus, that we pray. Amen. All right, you can be seated. Old Testament lesson today is from the book of Amos, chapter 3. Amos chapter 3 and verses 11 through 15. Hear now God's word. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, an adversary shall surround the land and bring down your defenses from you, and your stronghold shall be plundered. Thus says the Lord, as the shepherd rescues from the mouth of the lion two legs or a piece of an ear, so shall the people of Israel who dwell in Samaria be rescued with the corner of a couch and a part of a bed. Hear and testify against the house of Jacob, declares the Lord God, the God of hosts, that on the day I punish Israel for his transgressions, I will punish the altars of Bethel, and the horns of the altar shall be cut off and fall to the ground. I will strike the winter house along with the summer house, and the houses of ivory shall perish, and the great houses shall come to an end, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Now, if you look in your order of worship, we come now to a time of a general prayer of confession where we can come before God and confess our sins, and we follow that with a silent time of personal confession. And together we pray, our gracious God and Father, please forgive us of our many sins. Too often our hearts have been hard. Our spirits have been proud, our tongues have spoken evil, and our desires have been vain. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Transform us by the renewing of our minds. Make our hearts gentle, spirits humble. Tame our tongues and transform our minds through your word and spirit. Grant that our every thought, word, deed and desire would bring honor to your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. Amen. And dear Lord, please now hear our prayers that we lay before you, who is so quick to forgive. And Lord, even now, confessing our sins, we do so corporately and we do so here, but we, if we were silent throughout the day, they pile up. Make us aware always of our sin, that we may know of your great grace, not that we can wallow or just focus on the sin, but through the one who saved all sinners, even your Son. And Lord, we do pray for those this week, members of our congregation that we bring before you, especially Pastor Jim and his family, and I know they're tired, but and thank you that with the passing of his father and our friend Stuart, we can have a wonderful model. Pray for Tom Allison, Bill Clark, and Dick Bastrick. It's so good to be praying for people for so long and then to see them back. God, we pray for little James Tompkins. Pray for J.D. Hanley with his physical therapy and his vision and returning to school. Pray for Terry Gates. Pray for the continued recovery of her, Don and Sue Birdwell. For Landy Campbell and Susie Garner. for Vicky Kivett's nephew, Tony. Got to pray for the leaders of this church. So thankful for this congregation, and I pray that with your wisdom and your love for each other that they would lead. Pray for the leaders of this country. I pray that we would discover and rediscover a great nation again. Lord, I pray for a strong church all throughout this country and around the world, that we in our part and everyone in their part would be emboldened for your name's sake and for your glory. And we sing everywhere we go. We greet each other with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. We worship and pray as we ought, and even praying as our Lord taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, if your general prayer of confession didn't do it, perhaps that Book of Amos didn't do it. I don't know how many of you have been poking around the Book of Amos as of late. But I'll tell you, on a personal note, it's actually one of my favorites. When Jim sends out, you know, what's going to be in the bulletin and everything like this, I'm always very happy to read certain portions of Scripture. Yes, it is all inspired and wonderful, but there are certain portions that I love. Amos is one of those. And it's just on a personal note, because Amos, if you don't know, was nobody from nowhere who just shows up and starts talking. Now, when he does, it's not great. Most of it is what we read there in chapter 3. It's chapter after chapter after chapter of that. Amos saying, these summer houses and winter houses and all this stuff that you had, you're focused on this, and here's this judgment and that judgment, and you've been doing this and you've been doing that, and here it is. All the meanwhile saying, hey, look, I'm not a prophet or son of a prophet, but here it is. But the assurance of forgiveness is, even in all of that, every now and then, multiple times, Amos reminds them of the pattern. Yeah, you're deep down this hole. You've been arrogant. You've been worldly for a long time. But seek me, God speaking through Amos, and live. And one verse later, seek the Lord and live. Even in around, and it may be this way in your life, where all around you, it's just these thunders and threats. All this condemnation all around you, worry, anxiety, this is what's about to happen to me. You know what? I've drifted into whatever it is. And in the midst of all that, the jewel of the assurance of the simplicity of salvation is seek me and live, because when you seek, you will find. Knock, and it's open to you. We know of this. Now, some of us may have been at it so long, you say, I have him. I've sought him and I have him. I am his and he is mine. And you may be here today still seeking, but in seeking is finding, and in the finding is living, living the true life. Just like we're going to sing, there is welcome for the sinner and more graces for the good. There is mercy with the Savior. There is healing and his blood. And in seeking that blood, you can know that you are healed and forgiven. And all God's people said, amen. So now let's sing about that wideness of God's mercy. Grab your hymnals, stand for hymn number 42.
Yeah.
you. Please be seated. Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We welcome you here. It's good to see you out on this Lord's Day morning. And again, if you're a visitor, stop by and meet Travis or me or King. We'd love to get to know you personally. We're glad to have you with us today. Please pass the attendance registration down your aisle if you don't mind. And when it reaches the far ends, pass it back to the middle and welcome those around you and greet them in the name of our Savior. Wednesday night series continues during the season of Lent. Dr. David Lawrence teaching us on God's prophetic word. Dinner starts at 9:30. You may go online and make your reservation. Pardon? Did I say 9:30? Something starts at 9:30, I'm sure, but 5:30. It's been one of those weeks, you know. I'm sorry. You're going to hear about another mistake I made shortly, so just hold on. To err is human, to forgive is divine, right? 5:30 dinner, and we'll have a good time together, and we hope you'll join us. I believe, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong again, that next Sunday is when we spring forward. Is that right? That is right. I'm right about something, Tim. So move your clocks forward. Go to bed a little early. And good news is the days are going to last longer. So I believe I'm going to be quiet now. And the call for God's tithe and our offering. Let's worship God this morning with his tithe and our offerings.
Thank you.
Father, you have been so good to us, and whom much is given, much is required. And so we lay our tribute before you, and we worship and adore you and ask you to take these gifts and multiply them and use them for the furtherance of your kingdom and the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's turn back to the fourth chapter of John once again as we conclude our study of Jesus' remarkable conversation with this Samaritan woman, a very unlikely candidate for salvation. You recall that she had had five husbands and was run through all of them and was working on number six here. And the Lord Jesus Christ very cleverly engaged her in conversation, which was a no-no for a Jewish man, because the Jews and Samaritans were not on speaking terms. And having cleverly engaged her in conversation, he subtly confronted her about her sin. "Go call your husband," he said. And that was a big no-no for her. She didn't want to go there. And so she did what unbelievers often do when confronted or cornered: they run. She didn't literally run, of course, but figuratively she did, as she tried to redirect the conversation and have a little academic conversation. "Where's the right place to worship Jesus, Gerizim or Jerusalem? We say Gerizim, your people say Jerusalem. Which one's right?" And Jesus had none of it. Little did she know, she was far more blessed than she realized. He had her from the get-go. He had her before hello, as the old movie says. And very graciously took the scales off her eyes and the chains off her heart and revealed himself to be the Messiah, the Christ of God. So what happened next? We come to that part of the story this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your mercy seat, where our souls do find retreat and rest, safety. So we pray that you would bless us as we take refuge there this morning, as we come to your word. Where else should we go? You alone have the words of everlasting life. So speak to us that we may hear and live, through Christ our Savior. Amen. John 4, beginning in verse 27. "Just then the disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman. But no one said, 'What do you seek?' or 'Why are you talking with her?' So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, 'Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?' They went out of the town and were coming to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, saying, 'Rabbi, eat.' But he said to them, 'I have food to eat that you do not know about.' So the disciples said to one another, 'Has anyone brought him something to eat?' Jesus said to them, 'My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Do you not say there are yet 4 months and comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see the fields that are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true: one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap for that which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. 'He told me all that I ever did.' So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with him, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, 'It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world.' After the 2 days, he departed for Galilee, for Jesus himself had testified that a prophet has no honor in his own hometown. So when he came to Galilee, the Galileans welcomed him, having seen all that he had done in Jerusalem at the feast, for they too had gone to the feast." All flesh is grass, and all its loveliness is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, flower fades, and the word of our God stands forever. Amen. In Jesus' day, Judaism held a very low view of women. In fact, there's an ancient Jewish prayer that says in part, "Blessed art thou, O Lord, who has not made me a woman." You laugh. No comment. For a rabbi to spend his time talking with a woman in that day was considered to be a significant waste of time. In the Jewish Mishnah, which is a collection of oral tradition handed down through the generations, there's a passage that reports Rabbi Eliezer teaching that to give a woman the knowledge of the Torah, what the Torah being the first five books of the Old Testament, was as bad as teaching her lechery. I just share that with you so you understand why the disciples marveled. Verse 27, just then his disciples came back. They'd gone to get food, if you remember from last week. Jesus was left alone with the woman at the well. The disciples returned and they marveled that he was talking with a woman. He was Jewish, she was Samaritan, he was male, she was female. He was a rabbi, not just talking with a woman, not just talking with a Samaritan woman, but talking with an immoral Samaritan woman, and it blew their minds. We don't typically catch the impact. The Bible always seems to understate things. They were amazed that Jesus would talk with this particular woman. And I say all that to remind us this morning that Christianity was the great force that emancipated women in the ancient world. The Lord Jesus Christ engaged the hearts and minds of women and blessed them and worked with them, and many of them supported him in his ministry. And the early church picked up on his example and continued the emancipation, the exaltation even, if you will, and advocated and embraced the sanctity of every human life and the sacred distinction of the genders, which is so controversial today. That said, notice first of all here, we've got a brand new evangelist. Verses 28 and 29. So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, "Come see a man who told me all I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" She was hot. It was the middle of the day. She was thirsty. She wanted a drink of water. But all of a sudden, she didn't care about that. She left her water jar and she made haste to go to town and tell people, "You've got to come see this man. He's told me a lot about myself. He knew I'd had five husbands. I don't know how he knew it, but he knew it. And he knew I'm working on number six. Come see this man." You know, when the Lord takes the scales off our eyes and the chains off our hearts, our priorities get rearranged and something becomes much more important to us, because we're thrilled to be born again, right? We're thrilled to know the Savior of the world. You think back to the incarnation of the Lord and when the angels appeared to the shepherds, what'd they do? They have a committee meeting, elders meeting. They left the sheep. You're never supposed to leave the sheep. But they made haste to go see the newborn king, didn't they? New priority. And suddenly they became evangelists and published abroad what they'd seen and heard. Or you think about the disciples and how Jesus called the disciples. And Mark's account makes good use of that word immediately. Immediately, they left and followed him. They left all and followed him. If they were tax collectors, they left their posts. If they were fishermen, they left their nets. A new priority, a new excitement. Mary Magdalene saw the risen Lord. She didn't go get an ice cream cone. She made haste to go tell the other disciples, left whatever she was doing. And so with this Samaritan woman, this revelation, this realization, this light could not be hid under a bushel. An unlikely convert and a very unlikely evangelist, but that's what she became. She went to her own people and said, come, you've got to see, got to meet this man. I wonder why we are so reticent most of the time to talk about Jesus. I hear people say, well, I don't have the gift of evangelism. When was the last time you talked to somebody about Jesus? This morning. Well, now you're at church. That doesn't count. Did we approve her membership? Might have to invoke that probationary status. Start all over. Most of us are, you tell me if I'm wrong, my theory is most of us are reluctant to talk about Jesus in the marketplace, in the world out there, for whatever reason. People do say, oh, preacher, I don't have the gift of evangelism. You think this woman had the gift of evangelism? You think she even knew what that is or that was? And the problem is not that we don't have this or that gift, it's that we don't have love. Love for the Lord. Love for people. We don't care enough about other people who need to know the Lord Jesus Christ. It was never a problem for my wife and me to tell people when one of our five kids had been born. And I bet it wasn't a problem for you either, or your grandchildren, or when you got engaged, or something great happened to you. Because shared joy is twice the joy. No one has to make you do it. You just want to do it. And if we are thrilled with the Lord Jesus Christ, as we should be, for all he's done for us and all he's given to us, the joy, the life, the love, the peace, the forgiveness, the cleansing, it ought to be so easy. We ought to be so ready to testify, not to mention we've been saved from eternal wrath. Sometimes, I tell you, sometimes unbelievers are ahead of us, and they seem to get it quicker than we do. Remember that famous story about Charles Peace, who was a convicted criminal in Leeds, England, and being led to the scaffold on what was called his death walk. And he was accompanied by the chaplain. And the chaplain was reading Bible verses, according to the biographer, reading them routinely and sleepily. Verses about the wrath of God and hell and the fire that never goes out. Charles Peace was no believer, but he was shocked at the indifference with which the chaplain read those verses. And he finally stopped before he reached the scaffold and turned to the chaplain and uttered these famous words. I think you've heard them. Sir, if I believed what you in the Church of God say that you believe, even if England were covered with broken glass from coast to coast, I would walk over it if need be on hands and knees to think it worthwhile living and think it worthwhile living just to save one soul from an eternal hell like that. We forget. And for whatever reason, we don't have the same zeal this new convert had, an unlikely one, a new evangelist. But second, maybe she knew something else we need to know. There's a great incentive. Verse 35, Jesus said it himself, do not say there yet 4 months, then comes the harvest. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Now, ripe for harvest. I think Jesus would say to us, look across the street. There's a mission field. Look in your neighborhood. There's a mission field. Look at the workplace, your workplace. Young people, look in your school, your classrooms, your peers. Somebody's ripe. Remember when Jesus called Peter and James and John to be his disciples? It's recorded in Luke 5. And Jesus made that emphatic declaration. From now on, you're going to be fishers of men. Do you remember what preceded that? Those men had been out fishing. I'll refresh your memory. They'd been out fishing. And they hadn't caught any fish. And they'd been up all night. And they hadn't caught any fish. And they were on the shore washing their nets, tired, probably frustrated, unhappy, ready to go home and go to bed. And along came Jesus and preached a sermon because there was a crowd there. And when he finished the sermon, he said, here's the practical application for today's sermon. Boys, take your nets back out and let them down for a catch. Which Peter didn't appreciate. Master, he said, we have toiled. Hear that word? Toiled all night and caught nothing. But Jesus won the Mexican standoff and he said, okay. I can just hear him. Okay. At your word, we'll go let down the nets. And you know the rest of the story, right? They caught so many fish, their nets began to break, and their boat began to sink, and they had to call the other buddies, bring your nets and bring your boats, and theirs were full, and they began to sink. And in that context, Jesus said, this is the way it's going to be from now on. From now on, you're going to be fishers of men, because the fields are white to harvest. I'll tell you why I think we're reticent to talk about Jesus. Because we're pessimistic. By nature, we just don't think it's going to work. We think people are going to refuse him, and even worse, we think they may not like us. And we're important to us. Jesus is saying, get rid of that pessimism. The fields are white to harvest. You're going to be fishers of men. We say, well, but Lord, our theology teaches us that people are dead in sin. And, you know, dead people, they don't do much. And we can preach great sermons and give them great books, but they're dead in sin. Yes, it does tell us that. But our theology also tells us that the gospel is the power of God to salvation for all who believe, the dynamite of God. And it tells us faith comes by hearing this word. And it tells us this word will never return to us void. So why be pessimistic? Be optimistic. You will be fishers of men. I remember many years ago leading an evangelism workshop in St. Croix. I have no idea why I was the one to do it, because I was ill-qualified. I don't think I'd graduated from college yet. And there were 30 or 40 or 50 people in this room, and I was supposed to tell them how to do evangelism, and then we were going to go out and knock on doors on other parts of the island and talk about Jesus. And I told them what little I knew. I shared a little bit about the Romans road map and a couple other things. And then the last thing I said was, now people, let's be realistic here. That's a nicer word than pessimistic. But I was pessimistic. I said, let's be realistic here, you know. It takes a miracle for anybody to believe. And I just don't want you to have unrealistic expectations. You know, we just go out there and sow the seed and we'll leave the results to the Lord. And off we went, two by two. And I had two people with me, and we knocked on the first door, and a nice single lady let us in and offered us a cup of coffee or something. And we began to talk, and I shared the gospel, and I finally got to the big question. I said, well, would you like to become a Christian? And she said, yes. And I said, what'd you say? She said, yes, I would. I said, did you say you would like to become a Christian? It was just like low-hanging fruit. And it was like the Lord slapped me. Oops, sorry about that. It's like the Lord slapped me in the face and said, don't you be pessimistic, my son. So I got the message. What about you? Remember where you were once upon a time? And you were ripe. And the Lord worked. And the Samaritan woman, people would have said, no way, no way that Samaritan woman will ever become a believer in Almighty God. And now she's a believer and an evangelist as well. I may have shared with you previously the story about John MacArthur, a pastor at Grace Community out near Los Angeles. And MacArthur was on an airplane one time, and he prayed, like I bet all of us have, that no one would sit next to him. Because he had to meet a publisher's deadline. And he had his books and things and a Bible. His prayer was not answered. Somebody sat next to him, a gentleman. But the man fell asleep. So all was good. MacArthur was working away. And then suddenly the man awakened. And he saw all the books and whatnot. And he asked MacArthur, he said, sir, what do you do? And MacArthur thought, oh no, here we go. And so MacArthur said, well, I'm a teacher. He didn't say preacher, he said, I'm a teacher. And the man said, what do you teach? He said, well, I teach the Bible. And the man said, really? That's fascinating. He said, you know, I recently was listening to some people talking about having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Could you tell me how to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? And somewhere over the Grand Canyon, that man became a believer. And John MacArthur kind of got slapped on the face by Almighty God, too. We have a new evangelist, which could be you and me, as well as this Samaritan woman. Great incentive. And finally, third, we notice a glorious harvest. Verse 39, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all I ever did. And then you notice he stayed two more days. And we come to verse 41, and many more believe because of his word. And they said to the woman, it's no longer because of what you said that we believe. We've heard for ourselves. And we know this is indeed the Savior of the world. For many years, decades, centuries, Samaria had lain in the darkness of unbelief. And all of a sudden, one day, one man asked one question of one woman, and there was this incredible harvest of souls throughout Samaria. And if you look at verse 30, we read that they went out of the town, they being the Samaritans, and were coming to him. And the Greek language suggests that they were coming in columns of people streaming to see the Lord Jesus Christ, which I would suggest to you is a foreshadowing of exactly what will happen at the end of the age. In fact, yesterday, many of you were at the memorial service for my father, and as that service ended, the organist played what I think is one of the finest hymns ever written, and especially appropriate for funerals and memorial services. We just don't sing it very often. For all the saints who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the world confess, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. And I believe it's the last stanza of that hymn that says, from earth's wide bounds and from ocean's farthest coasts, through gates of pearl, stream in the countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, Alleluia, Alleluia. That's what it's going to be like. What we have here in Samaria is just a foreshadowing of that great streaming. The book of Revelation speaks of a multitude no man can number when the Lord will gather his elect from the four corners of the earth. and from every nation, tribe, people, and language, this multitude no man can number will gather before the throne, come streaming in and sing, "Salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb who sits upon the throne." The book of Amos, which that was the wrong chapter I put in the bulletin this week. I have to confess I've had a bad week. Travis, you did a great job with chapter 3. I meant for it to be chapter 9. And it's all my fault. We have a lot of proofreaders, but none of them would have known I meant for it to be chapter 9 instead of chapter 3. But if you were to look very briefly at chapter 9, you would see a little more optimistic tone. And in verse 13, we would find these words, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when the plowman shall overtake the reaper, and the treader of grapes, him who sows the seed. The mountains shall drip sweet wine, and all the hills shall flow with it." It's metaphorical language, picturing a time of unprecedented fertility. Sowers and reapers, and reapers following closely upon the heels of the sowers, and then the sowers following right after the reapers, and the reapers right after the sowers, and the seed is planted, and there's no intervening period of time. The seed sprouts, and there's an immediate harvest. That's a little happier, wouldn't you agree? It's a little happier picture than what you read earlier. But thank you for faithfully doing what the bulletin said. All my fault. Well, you get the picture. And I suppose it's fair to say that this might all sound good, but realistically, we watch the news, don't we? And we'd have to say that Christianity is, in our country, certainly struggling. And the church seems to be waning, not waxing, but waning, and in Europe. But I'll just say, don't underestimate the great soul hunter, as John Piper called him. Because in other parts of the world, there are great things happening. In Africa, at the beginning of the 19th century, there were very few Christians. And today, there are more believers than there are adherents of any other faith. And if you were to go to Nepal and South Asia, I think in Nepal, there were 15,000 believers in 1970. And 30 years later, there were 400,000 believers. So the Lord works when, where, and how he pleases. But he has said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against me." I love the story of George Whitefield. I'll close with it. George Whitefield, the great evangelist and Anglican outdoor preacher. And in February 1739, his heart was drawn to the coal miners in Kingswood, Bristol, England. And these coal miners, you must understand, were vulgar and violent and illiterate and mired in disease, degradation, and death, a vicious cycle. They and their families were illiterate. They were shunned by the city folk. But Whitfield's heart was drawn to them. And so he went in full clerical attire to preach outdoors in February. It's cold. And he found a couple hundred miners that would listen to him preach. And he stood under a tree. And the accounts differ a little bit according to who you read, but it might well have been the very first day that one very vulgar coal miner climbed a tree and relieved himself upon Mr. Whitefield, to the derisive laughter of all the other coal miners. But he just kept on preaching about the love of Christ. And he couldn't keep him out there too long. It was cold and they had work to do. Biographers tell you that their faces were black with cold and dirt, just caked on, baked on almost. But as he preached, he noticed what he called white gutters from their tears, washing away the dirt on their faces. And do you know, the next day there were 2,000 coal miners that came to hear him preach. And by Sunday of that week, there were 10,000, including some people from the city. And by March the 25th, 1739, there were 23,000 people that went to hear Mr. Whitfield preach the love of Christ to people that we'd have labeled just like the Samaritan woman. No way. Beyond the reach of God's love. But how wrong, because there is that wideness in God's mercy, like the wideness of the sea, which is going to make heaven such a fascinating place. Because I think Nicodemus will be there, and Samaritans will be there, and coal miners will be there. You and I might squeeze in by the grace of God. And I would predict that there will be columns of people streaming in from China and India and Africa and North America and Europe and South America because of the great soul hunter who always wins. Christ, as our closing hymn says, Christ shall have dominion over land and sea, earth's remotest regions shall his empire be. Father, we praise you for the great soul hunter and praise you that he found us, saved us, won us, and may he now use us to go tell it on the mountain and spread the good news of our blessed Redeemer. In his name we pray. Amen.